A bad storm had just passed through Burlington County when Officer Ange Quinn spotted something hovering over Route 130, which runs between Burlington and Bordentown. On June 20th, at approximately 6:40 p.m., I was traveling on Route 563, south of Chatsworth, near the Franklin Parker Reserve Speedwell entrance. I was looking to see what the parking situation there was for future hikes, so my eyes were on the right side of the road. Out of the periphery, I saw what I thought was a groundhog on the left. At least it looked like it. It was very large. I realized it would have been huge for one to be like that. So the size I saw was roughly 4 feet tall, standing on two legs. It reminded me physically of a groundhog. I did not get a good look at the face and I almost continued, but decided to turn around about 150 yards up on a dirt road to the right. I pulled in, turned around, and headed back to that location. There is a bend in the road there. It bends around to the right, and on the way back, as I made it past the bend, approximately 30 yards in front of me, the creature was still there. It was now fully turned towards me. I could see that it looked like a cross between Curious George and the character Chaka from the Land of the Lost. Its face and hands, as well as the tops of its feet, were hairless and light tan in color. The fur it was covered with was golden brown, a little darker than a golden retriever, very much like the color of a groundhog. I could not see the nose. When I locked eyes with it, I could see just the whites. I stood there for a second or two when I rounded the bend, and then it took off, passing back into the swampy area. It ducked behind a short bush when I drove past it. I could no longer see it. I turned the car around yet again, and when I went by a second time, it was gone. I waited there a bit to see if I could see anything moving in the field. I couldn't, so I considered it done and took off. It was a couple of days before I shared the experience with my family and friends. In that period of time, I thought for sure somebody was going to report a missing kid in a Halloween costume. When the thing took off running, it was fast. I would describe it as the fastest kid on the 10-12 baseball team. We had really bad storms that night and my commute was a disaster. It poured all through that area, and I thought it was odd that the thing I saw appeared to be dry, at least its fur was, which would lead me to believe it was under some sort of covering or underground. Of course, there are always skeptics out there suggesting this type of ferocious cryptid is just some innocent child dressed up in a puffy Halloween costume on Hallow's Eve. But why would it be out there, of all places? Or maybe Officer J. Quinn simply mistook an actual groundhog for something bipedal. Unfortunately for those skeptics and doubters, a J. Quinn is a legitimate officer who was on duty at the time of the sighting and has never been known to mislead. Over the years, there have been reports of other sightings in this area of Bordentown, New Jersey, where the creature is said to dwell. So, this guy had been abused as a child by his uncle. When he started talking about him sober, his face would scrunch up. He would talk through his teeth like hissing like, spitting as he talked. He would only do this sober. When he was high, he didn't care anymore. That was the point of the drugs. One night we were having a hard time getting drugs. We hadn't had any since the day before, so quite sober for the two of us. This is the guy who threw me through a closet door just a few weeks prior. He was violent, yelled, name called. He hurt me a few times pretty good. But I was really messed up back then. It had already gotten to the point where I knew the end was near. It was time for me to get my life together, and certainly time for me to get away from that hole. I was standing on the edge of the cliff, just about to jump. Then that night, when he realized no one had any dope, and he wasn't going to get any, he started talking about his uncle. We were sitting in the bed facing the TV at the foot of the bed, so I was turning my head to the right looking at him as he talked. It started calm and quickly escalated into the spitting angry talk. He started hitting the bed in front of him with his fist as he raged, and I was terrified to look at him. I stared forward for what seemed like forever. Then, for whatever reason, I turned to look at him, and I saw exactly as you described. It was like a face over a face, or a face behind a face, and it wasn't human, and it wasn't good. I can't put into words the terror. It consumed my whole body. I've never felt that level of fear, and I hope I never do again. I jumped up from that bed and ran. I had a bicycle sitting outside on the porch. I grabbed that friggin' bike and mounted it in the front yard and pedaled into the street. I could hear him busting through the front door and his footsteps as he started running after me. He yelled at me, "I swear to God I'm going to beat the F out of you when I catch you. I'm going to beat the shit out of you." And he growled as he ran after me. There was that moment when I didn't have the bike going fast yet and was still accelerating, and he almost caught up. Then I reached speed and left him behind. I was praying that my bike chain held on. It liked to fall off if I tried to accelerate too fast. Somehow it didn't fail me. I made arrangements for inpatient rehab that weekend. They had a bed open up the following Monday, and I've been sober ever since. That was May of 2006. I've told the devil face story many times since then. I know what I saw. It was pure evil, and I don't need any more convincing that evil can possess people. He definitely was. I probably was too. The devil loves chaos, and despair, fear, anger, violence, you get the picture. I choose today to distance myself from anything that resembles any of that. Thanks for the reminder. I haven't thought about him for a while. I need to be reminded. The devil is real, and I have a choice where I want to go. If I follow the rules, I get the good stuff, and if I don't, well, I've seen a glimpse of it, and no thank you. I decided to try a creek in the Cohutas, North Georgia, where three creeks merged at around 2600, hoping to catch trout or one of the local bass species. After driving to the location, spending quite a bit of time on dirt roads to get to there, it is very clear based on the overgrown parking lot and lack of trash or other signs of humans that this was not a frequently used trail. At the start of the trip, that's exactly what I was hoping for. As I begin to head down the trail, it becomes pretty clear the descent is much steeper than I expected from Google Maps. After descending roughly 800 over the stretch of a half mile, I'm already nearing what I think is the end of trout water, but as I mentioned earlier, they have black bass species that live only in this area to target as well. The trail has completely flattened out and parallels the river, which has several creeks feeding into from higher elevations, giving me hope the water will be cold enough. For the first 2 miles, the creek is too narrow and shallow for me to even consider trying to fish it. As I make it further in, eventually enough creeks have merged that the water is consistently at least 6 inches deep, with little pools maybe a foot deep. Stream is about 6-10 feet wide. Once I reached this point, I began to fish the creek anywhere I could feasibly bushwhack to the bank. There weren't many spots I was able to do this. The whole time I'm hiking and fishing, I'm keeping an eye out for any tracks or signs of bear activity. Still a little on edge from running into a few the week prior, and knowing that the next person to come along won't just be 10 minutes away like last week. Around the 5 mile mark, I see my first sign that anything else has ever been out there. It's a track, 3 feet long, 4 fingers, 2 pads on the heel, no claws. Another 50 feet, another track. 50 feet past that, I come up to a 2 feet tall game trail that appears to lead to a bedding area for something. I'd assume the track belonged to a bobcat or coyote. No claws makes me think cat, but I'd think it was on the big side for a bobcat. At this point, I hadn't had a bite and decide to head back to the truck. I reach the bottom of the hill to climb back the last stretch. I see a bad sign. The third set of tracks I see all day that are not mine or the ones I previously described belong to a bear. 2 tracks. Several trees in the area have also had pieces of bark ripped off. Saplings were ripped up. Now all of the missing bark was facing downhill, so I convinced myself I just wasn't able to see it earlier, and I must have missed the tracks. This is about all I can come up with since that trail up is the only way out. Not even 5 steps into my ascent, I found the bear. As I was 90 degrees with a bush to my left, it roared, and at least in my head, the entire bush shook when he did. I was close enough to touch the bush with my left arm. Unlike previous bear encounters at distance, where I was able to calmly stand my ground and then back off when that didn't work, I completely panicked. My first reaction was to turn my back to the bear and run before realizing what I was doing. As soon as I caught myself, I tuned back towards it, stood tall, arms out, and trying to talk as normally as possible as I retreated back 100 feet. As I'm standing here, I quickly realize I'm at a low spot on all four sides with zero visibility forward, backwards, or to my left, two of the three directions I'd assume the bear would come from if it were to advance on me. Moving to my right by about 30 feet puts me on slightly higher ground, but also takes me off the trail and most likely further reduces my visibility. I decide standing right where I was while everything cooled down was not any better or worse than anything else I could do. After waiting 30 minutes on my watch after the initial bear encounter, I have not heard the bear in a while. I decide to test with a rock throw in its direction since I'm getting pretty tired of the calling. The bear very loudly lets me know it is still there. I remember how remote the area is, and that I did not see a single track or sign showing human life had ever been on the 5 miles I walked. Another 30 minutes go by, both the fastest and slowest 30 minutes of my life. I repeat the process and it plays out exactly the same way, except 5 minutes later I hear the bear snort just a little to the left of where it had been. I wait another 20 minutes or so and now something has changed. I try throwing a rock at the bear again, no reaction. I think I held it together walking past where the bear was, and then ran a 2-minute half mile straight uphill. With only 5 creek chubs to show for the whole ordeal, I will never be back to that area again. When I was a teenager, a guy was screaming for help in the woods. I still remember I just got home from a friend's. It was around 8 p.m. My parents kept trying to yell back, "Hello," and "We are here," things of that nature. He wouldn't respond. Just intermediate calls for help. When I first heard his scream, I immediately ran and hid in my bedroom. It was a blood-curdling scream. Gives me chills just thinking about it. Filled me with fear just hearing his scream. The next day, everyone searched the woods and found nothing. Nothing was ever in the news. I will never understand. Why didn't he yell back? Where did he come from? We lived in the middle of nowhere. No close neighbors. Sometimes I think he was trying to lure us in. He would have seen our lights from our house. The woods was a hill. In May 2021, I took a trip to New Orleans, a city famous for its rich history and tales of the supernatural. We stayed at an Airbnb, a comfortable place that felt welcoming, if not a little old. One night, I woke up abruptly from a deep sleep, my gaze instinctively drawn to the bathroom. A peculiar certainty washed over me, there was someone in the bathroom. I squinted into the semi-darkness, my vision blurred without my glasses. I could discern the shape of a man, standing eerily in the bathtub, his back turned to me. I blinked, rubbed my eyes, but the figure remained. I felt an icy chill run down my spine, but eventually, sleep reclaimed me. On the day of our departure, all of us left the Airbnb, except for one girl from our group who had a later flight. Later, she confided in us about a strange experience she had after we left. She heard the sound of footsteps echoing down the hallway, and then a whisper as soft as the rustling of leaves, "Slave." Intrigued and disturbed, she researched the history of the area where our Airbnb was located. To her surprise and horror, she discovered that the site was once a bustling slave trading post. The realization struck us all with a sense of dread and melancholy, a ghostly echo from the past intruding into our present. The haunting memories of our stay in that Airbnb lingered long after our trip, a chilling reminder of New Orleans' spectral past. The city, rich with history, had shared with us a glimpse into its dark past, a tale of sorrow and injustice that time had failed to erase. This just happened a few hours ago. I have called and reported it to the police, and I am home safely, but guess I am still in shock. Could do with putting it down in writing to process it, and figured this is as good a place as any to share what happened. I finished work early today and so decided to go out for a run. I set out around 4:30 and decided my usual routes, which cross many roads, will not be very practical, and so I took an alternate route along a canal towpath and some pathways through woods that I knew would be less busy. Everything was going well. I was pushing myself steady until I got to a pathway on the way back around 6 kilometer into the route. It is a long straight path with a canal on the left side, and on their right there is wasteland where some factories used to be, but have mostly been demolished. It has been left abandoned for as long as I can remember and is overgrown with trees and weeds, but there are the odd bits of an old factory that for some reason weren't fully demolished. As I got level with one part of the factory, which still had some old metal fire escape steps attached to it, I noticed a rough-looking guy sat on the wall with his legs hanging down. He jumped to his feet as he saw me coming and shouted something, but I couldn't make it out. As I came level to where he was, I heard him say, "Wait there, can you help me find my phone?" He said this while he was running down the steps, and so I stopped as I got level with where the bottom of the steps was, meaning we were standing just a few feet apart, but with a fence in between us. It was a really old iron fence with vertical metal bars that have spikes at the top like you sometimes see around churches and things. He asked me if I would help him find his phone again, saying he had dropped it somewhere nearby, and asked if I could ring his number so he could listen for it. I felt I couldn't exactly refuse as my phone was strapped to my arm, so I said he could tell me the number, and I took my phone off my arm and unlocked it. He blurted out a phone number, but said it far too fast, and it didn't begin with 07, which made me start to feel like something wasn't right. Although I was beginning to suspect at this point, I wasn't really worried. I am in pretty good shape, had a big size and weight advantage over him, plus there was a fence between us. He didn't seem in very good physical shape and seemed like he might be homeless. I figured if he was trying to mug me for my phone, his only chance would be if he pulled a knife, so I made sure to stay a good distance away from the fence and kept my eye on where his hands were. So I told him I didn't catch any of the numbers because he said it too quickly, and he came out with another number. This time it did have 07 at the beginning. I entered 7 numbers, and then he started to look around and saying, "I can hear it, come and help me look," as he looked around at the ground. I was about to say that I hadn't even finished dialing when a much larger black guy appeared from behind a section of wall to my right. He was also really scruffy looking, and from the look of his eyes, it seemed like he was on drugs. He came out saying he could hear the phone ringing over towards him and beckoned me to come through a gap in the fence and help look. The white guy then said, "It is ringing, yeah." And I told him it was, even though I still hadn't dialed the last digits, and now I was sure they were trying to lure me to come over to that side of the fence. After 2 or 3 times of them both beckoning me to come and help, always insisting they could hear the ring, I heard the black guy say, "He's not going to fall for it." He said it in a hushed way as if he thought I wouldn't hear, but with it being out in the middle of nowhere, I could clearly understand what he said. The white guy then started acting quite aggressive and punched a tree, telling me he needed the phone badly and how his whole life was on the phone telling me to come and help them look for it. While he was punching the tree and ranting, the black guy had taken a few steps away to the right, meaning I couldn't keep my eyes on both at the same time. It was after 5 p.m. by this point and had gotten dark all of a sudden, which made the whole thing even more unsettling. I noticed there was a gap in the fence where some of the bars had been removed right where the black guy was heading, and I decided at that point to get the hell out of there and made a run for it. Neither of them said anything as I ran away, which makes me sure that they had malicious intentions. If they genuinely lost their phone and needed help, I would expect them to shout, "Where are you going?" or something to try and get me to come back, but they didn't shout anything. After sprinting for a good 20-30 seconds, I turned to see if they were chasing me. They were both stood on the path around where the gap in the fence had been, but were not chasing me. They were just standing there watching me run away. I continued running away, but kept looking back every few seconds until I was out of sight. It was at this point I got off the canal path and onto the roads. The person I spoke to on the phone to report it took my details and the descriptions, but seemed to think it wasn't anything worth worrying about, but said it will be investigated. The whole incident has left me a bit unnerved, and I am pretty sure I won't be jogging that route alone anytime soon. Sir, my name is Megan. I am forwarding a summary of an experience that I and a friend had in August 2010. My friend and associate Kyra and I traveled from Columbus, Ohio to Ravenswood, West Virginia on business. While we were there, I wanted to make a side trip to Gallipolis, Ohio to visit relatives I had not seen for quite a while. After our meeting and presentation, we drove onto Ohio Route 7 and traveled south along the Ohio River towards Gallipolis. We had a nice, though brief, visit with my relatives. Around 6 p.m., we left their home and drove a few miles north on Route 7 to check into a hotel near the local airport. Around 7:30 p.m., we decided to get dinner and found a quiet restaurant so we could eat and work. After we finished, Kyra needed to go to the store and pick up a few items that she forgot to pack. We headed to a Walmart that was nearby the restaurant. After we finished shopping, we were walking to the car when I noticed a woman running through the parking lot. When she reached her car, she looked back in the direction of the store and then hurriedly got into the car. I quickly looked in the same direction and saw what looked like a large bird flying above the roof of the store. It was difficult to see, but when it swooped downward, the parking lot lights would shine off of it. It looked like it was either oily or had shiny leather-like skin. Whatever it was, it had a wide wingspan. I would guess it reached 8-10 feet across. It circled above the store for about a minute, then just disappeared. We were both somewhat shocked at what we witnessed, but figured that it was just a huge bird. Since it was dark, I figured we had misjudged what it really was. We drove back to the hotel and decided to call it a night so we could get an early start on the drive home in the morning. I got ready for bed, but thought I'd watch some television first. By this time, it was around 10 p.m. or so. I must have dozed off fairly quickly because the next thing I remember is frantic knocking on my door. I stumbled out of bed and checked who it was. It was Kyra, and she was obviously upset. She rushed into my room and said, "It's here." "What are you talking about?" A little bit perturbed that she woke me up. She said that she was laying on the bed reading when she heard something in the hallway. She got out of bed, walked to the door, and listened to what she thought were scratching sounds. After a few minutes, the sound stopped, so she went back to bed. Not long after she lay down, she heard more scratching sounds, but from outside her window. Again, she got up and peeked through the curtains. This time, something looked back at her. Our rooms were on the second floor in the back section of the hotel, and both looked out onto a small parking lot and a large field beyond that. She could see what she described as a bald, ugly man with wings, who was looking directly at her with large, bulging eyes that lit up bright red. It was there for only a few seconds. It then spread its wings while running at the same time toward the end of the parking lot and lifted off the ground like a bird. "You're kidding, right?" I muttered to her. "Meg, I swear to God the thing is out there and it knows we saw it." I knew the only way I was going to get some sleep was to allow Kyra to stay in my room. The next morning we woke early, checked out, and drove back to Columbus. Kyra didn't mention the incident from the previous night during the ride. In fact, she has still never said anything else about it. We continue to be good friends and have a very good working relationship. But I got curious. I had never heard about the Mothman or any of the tales associated with it. I grew up in Texas and had only lived in Ohio for a few years. I moved into my mom's house after she had passed away. Her relatives lived throughout Ohio, but I had never been told any of the stories. This is the reason I am writing to you. We were near Point Pleasant, WV, when we had this encounter. Do you think that it is possible that this was a Mothman? I read some of your posts recently, and I'm starting to believe that Kyra actually saw something supernatural. In light of the prophecies of danger that this thing is supposed to warn people about, Kyra has had some bad luck and tragedy since that day. Her husband suddenly left her, she had a fire in her house, and she severely injured her leg in a fall. Could this be connected? I personally don't believe in predictions, either good or bad. But I will admit that these have been strange times since we witnessed whatever. I have been visited by otherworldly beings since 1974. I've had missing time many times over the past 48 years and have been abducted countless times. I did have one experience in 1999 that I had reoccurring dreams, a night that happened at my home in northern Wisconsin. I remember being taken from my bed, being led into my living room. I remember seeing things around me. I was shown a young girl 12 years old or so. I remember knowing that I was the child's father. I remember being so angry that I was used over years to create this abomination. I had, for as long as I can remember, maybe 25 years, kept a gun in my bed under my pillow. I had it in my hand. I remember being so angry that I was able to pull free, and I shot and killed the girl. I am a law enforcement officer. Since that day, I put it away, and I have trouble handling it. After shooting the girl, I remember being punished. I have had lumps in my arms that hurt and remain today. Each time that they come, they find different ways to make me suffer. All this time I hesitate to tell anyone else about any of my sightings, but I did report my story to MUFON. They called me and made me feel like a criminal. So last year, around November-September, I was driving home late at night, 2 or 3 a.m. from my buddy, who lived on the other side of the city, with my bike. I was stoned as F when I was leaving. Me and my buddy smoked a lot that evening. I had two routes in my head that time that get me home. One was 13 kilometers long trough of forest. The other was a much longer route trough the city around the forest. For info, I live in Hanover, Germany. The city is pretty much built around these big forests. I decided to go for the forest route, which was already a bad choice since I didn't have any lights on my mountain bike, and the forest is very dark at night. But I've been driving this route often since the other route is just waste of time. Was an easy decision for me back then, since I'm a 2 meters tall male and was armed with a knife. So in rolling into the forest and my route trough, it was this asphalted track for inline skaters and bikers. It goes all the way trough. I'm pulling out my cell phone to activate the camera light, since this was my only light source. I had and realized I forgot to charge the phone at my buddy's house. So my phone has this option: when it's below 5% battery level, you can only activate the camera light for a few seconds, till it turns off automatically and you need to turn it on again. Needless to say, it was quite stressful to drive like that. Always the light turning on and off. It rained that night too, but not much, more like foggy fine rain. I don't know what it's called in English, but we call it in German Niesel. Cause of that, I only could see what was close in front of me, like 10 or 15 meters view only. 3-4 kilometers in, the track takes a sharp curve. After I was taking it, I would see a white figure standing next to the road. It was dark as F late, and I'm literally in the middle of the forest. I was thinking about returning, but I decided in a matter of seconds to keep going, since I had a lot of speed on. I was rushing trough the forest. When I spotted the figure, I couldn't see much since I was like 20 meter away, but in seconds when I came closer, I could see that it was a man in white jacket, just standing there in darkness. Like I said, my phone was keep putting out the light, so I would have seen it if he had a light when my phone's light was off. So I'm going full speed towards that creepy guy standing next to the road. I was about 5 meters now from him, and he was just standing there motionless, like not even turning his head. Light goes out. 4 meters now. 3, 2. I put the light back on and bypass him. I see him in the face. He was the most unhygienic looking man I've ever seen. Full nasty beard, like a homeless guy, just staring at the track. It was this moment I would feel a heavy rumble under my tires. I almost crashed. The track where the man stood was full off sticks and branches, like a barricade. I think my mountain bike tires were saving my ass that day. Needless to say, I have bike lights now and don't take that route at night anymore. I believe that a lot of people get signs before something really bad is going to happen. 2 nights ago, I woke up screaming from a very lucid, horrible dream, where in the woods outside my house, I heard someone in pain calling for help. I go to them and find a naked humanoid deer creature that turned on me. I believe that thing was a skinwalker. Then last night around 3 a.m. I heard and felt what sounded like something very large hitting the side of my house. Very clearly I could tell it was happening in the area outside of my kitchen, and either next to or below my kitchen window. I was in my living room sitting on the couch where there is even a wall between the living room and kitchen. But this sound was so loud it could be heard throughout the whole house, and while I was already awake, the sound scared my cats, also woke up my sleeping daughter and partner. I could feel the wall behind me and the floor vibrate, along with the dishes and kitchen cupboards rattling around from the impact. This happened at least twice, I'm certain, maybe once more, but after the second time I was so scared I ran to check on my family. There was about a 10-second pause between the sounds. After the dream I had, I haven't been able to sleep in fear, plus the loud noises are keeping me up too. Made sure to lock everything just in case. I'm wondering if the events are connected at all. If anyone can give me tips or help ease my mind, I'd appreciate it. The other day I was driving home, and as I came around a curve, there was an animal that I thought was a goat at first. It ran away from me and got far enough away that I couldn't see it in my headlights, and it ran across the road and hid behind a bush. It was smart enough to pivot around the bush as I drove by it. It was extremely pale and looked like a camel shape. It moved like a Chinese dragon and looked like it was made out of a bedsheet. If y'all have any questions, please ask. I'm seriously trying to figure out what I saw, natural or supernatural. Don't know if this helps, but I'm from North Carolina, and this all happened next to a cow pasture. Wasn't a cow because they only have brown cows, no white ones. And I grew up around cows. They don't move look like that. It was probably about 4 to 5 feet tall and about 6 feet long. It was a pretty big animal. I am a female, 22. I am petite, really pale, and always messy hair. I was wearing loosened clothes, all white. Maybe you will guess where I am heading to. I was outside smoking while sitting on a chair in my front yard. I forgot to mention an essential detail. I live in the countryside. My street leads to fields and forests. The night here hits differently, if you know what I mean. The sky offers some great masterpieces freely to our starry eyes. So yes, I was just hyper-focusing on the sky. I just stood up and decided to take a picture. I wanted to reproduce it through painting. However, I was really disappointed by my lame camera. So I decided to head out inside to grab one of my parents' phones since their quality were better. While I was trying to take some pics, I felt a gaze on me. It was my new neighbor. She was staring at me. I was in my front garden, just in front of her house. I was waiting since in my front yard there is an automatic light. It flashes at any movement and lasts for like 20 seconds. Important element. So I was only visible for a few moments. It was pitch dark again. There are no street lights where I live, so I was relieved to feel invisible. As I was finally taking mesmerized pictures, out of the blue, the flash of the phone I was holding started to light up. The moon was right on the left side of her house, yet it looked like I was taking photos of her house. I heard her screaming. I put my hand on the flashlight, turned it off. I was petrified. I didn't know which option was the best. A. Fleeing right away in my house, so reactivated the flash, looking suspicious. B. Confronted her, also talking to her for the first time and explaining the whole situation because I scared her quite often. I will explain after the other option. C. Just disappearing in the dark and waiting. Okay, so I am a night owl and I love art. It is not unusual to see me outside standing right in front of my house or in the middle of the driveway past midnight, taking pictures, smoking, or just contemplating. So I spooked her multiple times. I know because she said that I was the weird neighbor to someone. One day I was playing in the front yard, playing with my cat with a red light laser, obviously late at night. I accidentally lighted my laser towards one of her windows, so a flashy red light point was visible. I heard her screaming, lighted up the room. I turned it off and I glanced at her. She was looking at me and shut the curtains. Back to the story, I decided to not move and wait. Then I was like, I should still continue taking pics. I heard loud voices, the front door opened. I heard them walking slowly towards their car and whispering. What was I supposed to do? I just took a last pic and headed to my house. As the flash went on, I was petting my cat. I heard her saying, again, this weird chick. As soon as I closed the door, I laughed out loud. Nervous reaction. Surely, I should find a way to talk to her, reassuring her that I am inoffensive or just remaining the weird neighbor. The Adirondack woods had always held a certain mystique for me. Towering trees, hidden trails, and an air of quiet isolation made it the perfect destination for my hiking adventures. One brisk autumn morning, armed with my backpack, hiking boots, and a sense of curiosity, I ventured deep into the heart of the Adirondacks, ready to explore a trail less traveled. The path I had chosen was overgrown, its markers faded and barely visible. But that only fueled my excitement. The idea of being alone in the wilderness, far away from the hustle and bustle of everyday life, was exactly what I needed. The tranquility of the woods wrapped around me like a comforting blanket as I hiked deeper and deeper into the forest. Hours passed as I walked in solitude, the only sounds being the rustle of leaves beneath my feet and the occasional distant call of a bird. The sun filtered through the thick canopy above, casting dappled shadows on the forest floor. I was in my element, disconnected from the world and at peace. It was as I rounded a bend in the trail that I saw a strange, elongated shape partially hidden behind a cluster of rocks and underbrush. My curiosity got the better of me, and I cautiously approached the mysterious object. As I got closer, my heart raced with a mix of fear and intrigue. What I discovered sent a shiver down my spine. It was a creature unlike anything I had ever seen before. Its body was a tangled mess of sinew and dark fur, its limbs unnaturally long and twisted. Its eyes were a piercing, unnatural shade of blue, and they bore into me with a sense of malevolence that chilled me to the bone. It was hunched over, gnarled claws digging into the ground, and I could feel the air grow heavy with its presence. In that moment, a feeling of dread washed over me. The cryptid, whatever it was, radiated danger. Instinct screamed at me to retreat, to turn and run as fast as I could. But fear kept me rooted to the spot, unable to tear my gaze away from those eerie blue eyes. As if sensing my fear, the creature let out a low, guttural growl that reverberated through the air. Every fiber of my being screamed at me to flee, and finally I listened. I turned and sprinted back down the trail, heart pounding in my chest, adrenaline surging through my veins. Behind me, I could hear the creature's growls growing louder, the sound of its pursuit echoing in my ears. Panic fueled my speed as I dodged branches and leapt over fallen logs. It was like a nightmare come to life, and I pushed my body to its limits, desperate to escape the clutches of whatever pursued me. Time seemed to blur as I ran, my breath coming in ragged gasps. I dared not glance back, my mind consumed by the single thought of survival. And then, suddenly, I burst through the trees and stumbled onto a more familiar part of the trail. I could see the parking area in the distance, and a renewed surge of energy pushed me forward. With every ounce of strength left in me, I sprinted towards my car, my heart pounding like a drum in my chest. I flung open the door, jumped inside, and slammed it shut just as the creature's snarls reached a crescendo. My hands shook as I fumbled for the keys and started the engine. As I pulled away from the trailhead, I stole a glance in the rearview mirror. The creature stood at the edge of the woods, its blue eyes burning with a mix of frustration and hunger. It watched me for a moment before disappearing back into the shadows of the forest. I drove away, my mind racing with the surreal events that had just unfolded. The adrenaline began to subside, leaving me with a mixture of relief and disbelief. I had encountered something beyond explanation, something that defied the boundaries of the known world. And as I left the Adirondacks behind, I couldn't shake the feeling that I had narrowly escaped a fate that I might never fully comprehend. In 2001, I was on the Navajo Reservation, where I had a mysterious encounter with a humanoid figure that bore a striking resemblance to the infamous Mothman. I, Jerry Garcia, was on duty with my partner when we spotted a white, human-like figure perched atop a mesa rock near Shiprock, New Mexico. The beam of our flashlight illuminated its skull-shaped head and enormous, glowing eyes. Its jaw was shrouded in long white hairs. The figure towered at 8 feet tall, with a wingspan of nearly 12 feet. As it launched itself into the sky, it took about 3 steps, gave a single flap of its wings, and soared over the horizon at a speed exceeding 80 miles per hour. I have to ask myself, what was this creature? Could it be another sighting of the Mothman, or something entirely different? The Navajo, one of the most recognized tribes in U.S. history, inhabit these lands. Is it possible that our territories are home to a host of unknown, terrifying creatures that not only dwell in the forests, but also in the remote regions? I invite you to share your thoughts on this incident below. Growing up, my parents filled my childhood with stories from their homeland, Jalisco, especially my father, who would recount tales about his haunted childhood ranch. But it was a story from my maternal grandfather that sent shivers down my spine. You need to understand that my grandfather was quite the character in the 1920s and 30s. He was a renowned womanizer and had a reputation for being a bit too fond of his drink. One story he told involved a night filled with drinking and gambling. He was returning home, riding his horse under the cover of the midnight sky after a particularly indulgent evening. That's when he saw her, a woman bathing in a nearby stream, stark naked. The sight was alluring, to say the least. She had her back to him, and her long, dark hair cascaded down her back, covering her like a veil. Inebriated and emboldened, my grandfather approached her, reaching out to grab her hair. But as he did, she turned around, and what he saw sobered him up immediately. Instead of a woman's face, he was met with the terrifying sight of a dog's face, complete with glowing red eyes. The fear that gripped him was palpable, and without a second thought, he spurred his horse into a gallop, racing back home as fast as he could. He later told me that he had never been so scared in his life. Over the years, I've heard 2 other people recount eerily similar tales about their relatives encountering a mysterious, beautiful woman bathing alone at night. It was always the same, the woman's back to them, her naked form seeming to lure them in, only to reveal a horrifying truth. It was only later that I discovered that these encounters were not unique. In fact, this creature had a name, La Sihuanaba, a legend known to frighten many who heard her tale. Her story, like my grandfather's, serves as a chilling reminder of the mysteries and dangers that lurk in the shadows of the night. I grew up in an almost 100-year-old house and had gone back home after graduating college. One night I woke up to a dark figure next to my bed. I wasn't even scared because I immediately thought it was either one of my parents or my little brother waking me up for some reason. It was dark, but it sort of looked like they were pointing toward my bedroom windows. But anyways, I was like, "Brother," no reply. "Mom," no reply. At that point, I was creeped out, but thought someone may have walked into my room. A couple of my family members sometimes sleepwalk, which has always scared me anyway, so I reached out my hand to nudge them awake. And that was when I realized there wasn't actually a human person there. It was so shocking and terrifying, I actually screamed really loud, stumbled out of bed, ran out of my room as fast as I could, woke my little brother up and told him. It was a feeling of terror I hadn't ever experienced before and haven't since. And because I spent a good chunk of time trying to figure out which family member it was, and generally not even being freaked out, I was convinced that it wasn't just me still half dreaming or something. This was 11 years ago. And with time, I've convinced myself it was some kind of hallucination. But whatever it was, I will absolutely never forget it. As backstory, my parents told us that when they bought the house in 1995, the previous owners told them straight up that there were angels, friendly ghosts was what they were suggesting, who lived in the house, notably on the 3rd floor, 2 bedrooms. My sighting was on the 2nd floor. But both of my siblings, whose rooms were on the 3rd floor, had had multiple experiences and even my dad, who is one of the most rational people I have ever met in my life, says he's 100% seen figures out of the corner of his eyes and heard weird shit. However, I had lived in the house since I was 5, and up until this point I never had had any experience, so I just thought it was all bullshit until then. A couple days later, my uncle came into town for my graduation party and stayed in one of the now vacant bedrooms on the 3rd floor, and maintains to this day that the bedroom door shut on its own, and something was physically holding it shut so he couldn't get out. Crazy shit, man. A couple years later, I had 2 separate terrifying experiences while dog-sitting for a neighbor on our block, but I didn't actually see anything. Coincidentally, one of my friends from grade school had lived in that house a long time beforehand, and I remembered him having told stories when we were kids that his oldest sister had done some creepy ghost sighting ass when she was really little. There was a specific story about his mom giving her a bath, and she wouldn't stop staring at the ceiling upward. His mom asked her what she was staring at, and she said, "The lady." His mom grabbed her and straight up ran out of the house. Anyways, I remembered that family had lived there, but honestly hadn't even thought about the ghost stories when I started dog sitting. The first experience, I had been out of the house, came back, and their dog wasn't at the door. She started barking as soon as she heard me come in, and it was coming from upstairs. I went up and she was trapped in the master bathroom. It was one of those old school bathrooms with 2 entrances, one from the hallway and one from the master bed, and both doors were closed. Obviously, I hadn't left her up there or anywhere near there. It was weird and super creepy. Maybe a night or 2 later, I woke up in the middle of the night to voices, and was obviously absolutely terrified, like fully frozen for a while, until I realized it was a speaker. Went into the master bedroom, and there was just a speaker on, playing shit. Even though I was supposed to sleep there and house sit the whole time they were out of town, I went home immediately after that and only came back during the day for the rest of the time they were out of town. I never imagined the forest I patrolled could harbor such sinister secrets. My name is Alex, and I was a park ranger stationed in a remote, dense forest known as Ravenwood. For years, I had been responsible for ensuring the safety of visitors and protecting the fragile ecosystem within its boundaries. Ravenwood was vast, ancient, and filled with mysteries, but nothing could have prepared me for the chilling events that unfolded deep within its heart. It all started one crisp autumn evening as I was concluding my rounds. The sun had already dipped below the horizon, casting long shadows among the towering trees. I was about to head back to my ranger station when I heard a soft, barely perceptible whisper that seemed to come from the very trees themselves. At first, I dismissed it as a trick of the wind, a figment of my fatigued imagination. But the voice persisted, growing stronger and more insistent with every step I took towards the source. It beckoned me deeper into the woods, its eerie, melodic tone drawing me in like a siren's song. I couldn't resist the allure of those whispers, and I ventured further, guided solely by their spectral voices. My flashlight cut a narrow beam through the inky darkness, revealing gnarled roots and twisted branches that seemed to reach out for me. My footsteps were muffled by the thick carpet of fallen leaves, but the whispers were always there, just ahead, just out of reach. Hours seemed to pass as I pressed on, the forest around me growing denser and more oppressive. The air grew cold, and an unnatural hush settled over the woods. It was as if nature itself held its breath, awaiting some terrible revelation. Finally, I reached a clearing deep within the forest, and there, bathed in the faint glow of the moonlight, I saw a colossal ancient tree unlike any I had ever encountered. Its massive roots writhed and twisted like serpents, and its branches loomed overhead like skeletal arms. The whispers grew more intense, swirling around me in a maddening crescendo. It was then that I realized the truth: these were not ordinary voices. They were the voices of the damned, the echoes of tormented souls that had become one with the forest. As I stood there, trembling with fear, the ground beneath me trembled, and the massive tree began to uproot itself, revealing a gaping, black maw at its base. From that abyss emerged a nightmarish creature, an amalgamation of roots, earth, and shadow. Its hollow eyes locked onto mine, and I knew that I had uncovered a horrifying secret hidden for centuries. The creature's intentions were clear. It hungered for my soul, and it was a fate that countless others had met before me. With a surge of adrenaline, I turned and fled, the whispers of the forest now shrieking in rage as I distanced myself from the ancient malevolence. I ran faster than I ever had, guided only by the light of the moon and the distant beams of my flashlight. The forest seemed to conspire against me, its roots and branches reaching out to ensnare me, but I was determined to escape the clutches of that eldritch horror. Hours later, I stumbled back into the safety of the ranger station, my heart pounding in my chest. I knew that I had uncovered a darkness that should have remained hidden, a secret that would haunt me for the rest of my days. I left Ravenwood, never to return, haunted by the whispers that still echoed in my mind. The forest had revealed its malevolent secret to me, and I had narrowly escaped its grasp. But I knew that Ravenwood would always be there, waiting for the next unsuspecting soul to venture too deep into its heart, and I could only hope that they would heed the warning of the haunted whispers and turn back before it was too late. As a National Guard agent, I've seen my fair share of crises, but nothing could have prepared me for this. Our orders were clear. Secure the classified government facility. Ensure no information leaks. Standard protocol for a security breach. Or so we thought. We arrived at the facility in Colorado, a nondescript concrete block hidden in the heart of the desert, under the cover of darkness. The main gate was busted open. Inside, it looked like a war zone. The place was ransacked, claw marks etched into the steel walls, blood splatters staining the white tile floors. But there was no sign of the perpetrators, no sign of life at all. As we delved deeper, we stumbled upon something straight out of a horror movie. The facility wasn't just a data center, it was a lab. A lab filled with cages, and in those cages we found the unthinkable. There were creatures, grotesque, monstrous hybrids of humans and animals. Some were dead, victims of the breakout. But many cages were empty. They'd escaped. We soon learned what these creatures were, chimeras, born of illegal genetic experiments. Unholy fusions of man and beast, they were unlike anything we'd ever seen. They were intelligent, strong, and deadly. They were the security breach we were here to contain. The hunt was on. We tracked the chimeras through the sprawling facility, each encounter more deadly than the last. These creatures were not mindless beasts. They used their human intelligence combined with their animalistic abilities to evade and attack us. They were the perfect soldiers, and we were their prey. Meanwhile, we began to uncover the truth. We found documents, reports, and video logs detailing the creation of these chimeras. This was a government-sanctioned project, funded by taxpayers, hidden from the public eye. The goal was to create a new kind of soldier, one with enhanced strength, speed, and resilience. Each document we discovered was more disturbing than the last. They had been playing God, and now we were paying the price. We fought the chimeras day and night, using every ounce of our training to outsmart and outmaneuver them. Each encounter left us more drained and desperate, but we couldn't let these creatures escape into the outside world. In the midst of this chaos, we found allies in unexpected places. Some of the facility's staff had survived the breakout. They were as horrified by the project as we were, and they helped us understand the chimeras better. Their insights proved invaluable in our fight. We finally cornered the last of the chimeras in the heart of the facility. It was the most human of them all, a chilling testament to the extent of the experiments conducted here. It fought savagely, but in the end, we managed to subdue it. Once the facility was secure, we had to confront the reality of what we'd uncovered. The conspiracy ran deep, reaching into the highest echelons of power. Our superiors demanded silence, but we couldn't let this atrocity be swept under the rug. August 1994. The month, year, and the memory are permanently etched into my mind. I'm Becky Katz, just an ordinary bookshop customer from Astoria, Oregon. That day, my son and I had decided to take a break from the city noise and spend the day collecting mushrooms near the fish hatchery by Blind Slough, 18 miles away from Astoria off the Columbia River. We had been at it since early morning, and it was around 8:30 a.m. when it happened. The morning mist was still lingering around the trees, the air crisp and clean. As we carefully navigated through the undergrowth, a sudden rustle caught our attention. We turned towards the noise, and that's when we saw it. It was a figure, gray-brown and larger than any man I'd ever seen. Its body was covered in thick, matted fur, and it had an unmistakable wildness about it. It looked somewhat like a bearded hunter, but its size and stature were far from human. I remember the moment our eyes met. It was only a split second, but it felt like an eternity. There was a look of surprise, maybe even fear, in its eyes. And then, just as suddenly as it had appeared, it turned and ran away, disappearing into the dense forest. My son and I were frozen in place, shock and fear rendering us motionless. When we finally came to our senses, we ran in the opposite direction, not stopping until we had reached the safety of our car. As we drove back home, we kept replaying the incident over and over in our heads. We were both trying to make sense of what we had seen. After some discussion, we arrived at the only possible explanation that made sense: we had seen Bigfoot. I still remember the feeling of disbelief, the adrenaline rush, and the fear. But more than that, I remember the sense of awe and wonder. We had witnessed something extraordinary that day, something few people get to see in their lifetimes. Since that day, our mushroom collecting trips have been filled with a sense of anticipation and excitement. We never saw the creature again, but the memory of that day remains as vivid as ever. It was a reminder that there are still mysteries in this world, waiting to be discovered. And sometimes those mysteries find you when you least expect them. I, Officer Lamage, reported a terrifying sighting of what I believe to be the legendary Mothman. My sighting occurred on highway in Wyoming. Suddenly, in front of me, right above a slow-moving car, was the figure of a man with his wings folded in across his back. The wings appeared to be leathery in texture, like a bat's, and were even pointed on the ends. A sort of sting protruded from the creature's belt line. I stopped my car and tried to get out when I saw the creature taking off in flight at an incredible speed. I would describe it as follows. It stood between 6 and 7 feet tall, had a wingspan over 14 feet wide from tip to tip, and large glowing red eyes. It flew at an angle towards the east. It made no noise other than a whooshing sound like air through its wings. It had claws on its feet and something on its back looking like two cylinders. I reported my sighting to the local PD, where I was laughed at, ridiculed, and finally forced into early retirement for psychological reasons. I was told that if I reported another sighting of this kind, I would be brought up on charges of mental instability. It's interesting to note that I am extremely well respected within the community. I'm an upstanding member of society with no history of family or personal mental illness or alcoholism. I am very much a regular guy with a wife and kids. This has been one hard creature to research due to the reluctance of people involved in the case that are willing to talk about it. I immediately went and checked the area where I think I initially came across something, which was just a short distance away. The road on which I saw it circles around, comes back up on the top of itself in an oval-like shape, with gravel roads going out in different areas of the farm. We were not able to find anything, but even my son said he thinks he saw something by one of those houses. It's no longer there, but maybe even a garden plot that had been abandoned long ago. The land has been farmed for probably decades now before being converted into pasture land. The entire sighting lasted approximately 3 seconds from me seeing it while driving until it was fully gone. Since the sight was airborne from my recollection, it was extremely large, stood right next to a tree. I saw a shine and the eyes were large as well, with what appeared to be claws on its feet. The creature had long hair or fur all over it. Most of it was covered by something that I said appeared like a cape or wings, even covering most of its body lengths. I couldn't tell if they were webbed, but there were definitely something attached to it, which we may have thought. I am 100% positive I saw this, and I'm actually very shaken up about it since I clearly have no explanation for it. My car stopped working immediately after the sighting, so I believe there's some sort of electrical interference occurring at the time. I believe it stood about 7 foot tall, dark in color, wings folded across its back, and extended like a stingray. My car stopped working after it took off into the air at an angle towards the eastern direction. But due to the electrical interference with my radio, which was turned off at the time of the sighting, which is also noted with other Mothman encounters, we were not able to find any evidence of anything. But we both believe I saw something and would like to help finding what I saw. I have two stories. First was about 1997, opening weekend deer season, Central California. I was sitting in camp after setting up the Thursday before the opener, had a campfire going. This was base camp for the whole season, so we set up everything. Sitting by the fire just BSing with my cousin, when three lights started making their way up the hill, about 8 feet off the ground. I thought they were possibly fireflies, none. This side of the Sierras, or maybe sparks floating from another fire. As they got closer, I realized they were about baseball sized and pretty consistently bright. They made their way up the side of the mountain, watched them for a good 4 to 5 minutes, they didn't fade. Just went over the hill out of sight. No drugs or alcohol involved, just some bright lights and weird feelings all weekend. Like being watched. Second was probably no more than 3 miles from the first place, opening weekend again, but this was about 4 years ago. Moving along the edge of a meadow, my 14-year-old nephew with me for his first archery deer hunt. I have bear tag as well. He points and whispers, "Bear, I see it, about 100 yards, pulling a log apart looking for grubs, wind in my favor, so I start stalking. Got to about 60 yards, pull the rangefinder, start putting it away and the wind swirled. I feel it on the back of my neck. The bear stands up on two legs. Not a bear, whatever it was about 7 feet, covered in black hair, half turned to me and walked away. On two legs, silently. Not super surprised by that, it was on a bed of pine needles. Was shooting light, but dark in the meadow. Wasn't a bear, and it was big. It was my best friend's birthday. We pitched tents in the backyard. 6 of us went for a walk on the dirt road in the canopy. On the other side of the canopy is the Willamette River. 4 of the friends kept walking further up the road. My friend and I sat down to talk in the shade. That's when rocks started to be thrown in the river. We thought our friends were trying to scare us. When we met up with them, they were mad at us because they thought we were trying to scare them by throwing rock in the water. After figuring out it was not any one of us, we were all kind of scared. As kids, we were told of bums and or drug growers on the banks of the Willamette. We were not thinking of Bigfoot at all. We turned and started to walk back to the yard, and there they were. One large Bigfoot standing in front about 7 to 8 feet tall, and 2 smaller ones standing behind about 6 feet tall. They came up from the riverside, stood in front of us and snorted. Maybe 10 seconds felt like forever, and then took off on 2 feet through the brush opposite from the river. I had never seen something move so fast and so quiet once they hit the brush. My friends ran, I stood frozen in fear. I believe due to shock, I blacked out the experience for a long time. It is one of the most horrible things to go through. Who do you talk to about this stuff? No one believes the story. I have met up with one of the people that was there. He says that he doesn't remember what he saw. He just remembers everyone being really scared and running back to the yard. It's so frustrating. I wish I would have never seen it so that I wouldn't have to believe. Here is one of the creepiest encounters I've ever, which took place in the spring of 2015. It's important to the story to know that I was basically a huge jerk leading up to what happened. See, I'm a graduate student, and I was at this point about 6-8 months into a new relationship with a woman named Sarah. If it matters, I am female and we were both around 30 at this time. The prior year, before I met Sarah, my best bud from school Josh and I had gone on a great camping road trip over spring break. This year, I messed up and basically double booked myself to go camping with Josh and with my girlfriend, because I am a scatterbrained idiot and I got confused about what plans had been discussed, solidified. Both Josh and Sarah were justifiably really pissed off and hurt, but I had made the plan with my girlfriend first, ultimately, so I had to flake on Josh. When it came time to planning, Sarah and I picked a campground in southwestern Pennsylvania with lots of good hiking. It's at least a 5-hour drive from where we live. We made reservations and I mentioned the plan to Josh. Well, it turns out, of all the campgrounds in the region, Josh had also decided to head to that one as it connected to a long bike trail he wanted to go on. He had decided to go camping alone, so we knew Josh would be at the campground before we got there. But things were super awkward between me and him, on account of my being an asshole and him being generally a bit depressed around that time. We stayed 3 nights and Josh was there for the first and second night. We'd rented out a small cabin, basically a prefab shed with bunk beds, because it was cheap and we have a leash reactive, wimpy about rain dog, and it's sometimes easier that way. Josh was tent camping in another spot. I think Josh and I were mostly planning on avoiding each other. He was rightfully still angry. Things were awkward, and I figured he needed some space from me. But it turned out only one bathroom was open on our side of the campground, since it was only early April and most of the campground was still closed down for the season. Josh's campsite was right next to the open bathroom, so we ended up seeing him when we walked to the bathroom at night. I saw heard signs of one or two other groups on the far side of the campground, but they had their own bathroom open over there, and we never really saw them. It's a very large and forested campground, and only small sections at either end were open for the season. The second night, Josh was out in his campsite when we came through to the bathroom before bed. It was after midnight at this point. Josh seemed super depressed, and we had a very strange and awkward conversation with him, took care of what we needed to in the bathroom, and headed back to our little shed down the road. The roads in this part of the campground were basically like an inverted F, with the bathroom above the top of the F. In between the two arms of the F was a stand of trees next to the main road, a small, locked shower building in Josh's campsite, furthest from the main road being the vertical line of the F. We were staying off the main road further down on the opposite side, so that night we'd cut past Josh's camp to get to the bathroom, but on the way back, we followed the road so as not to bother him, as he seemed in a bad mood. It was dark, and I'm easily spooked. We had the dog with us, which was somewhat reassuring, since he looks semi-tough despite being a nutcase and a wimp. But I'm looking around nervously, and as I glance over my shoulder, I think I see a man off to the side of us. My brain processes this very slowly, as I just caught a glimpse of him as I turned my head, and it was very dark. I convinced myself my mind was playing tricks. I didn't look back and silently walked with Sarah and the dog back to our cabin. When we got back to the cabin, I thought Sarah looked a little spooked, which is unusual, since she's a lot braver than me. Eventually she says, "That guy was really creepy, right? So shit. He was real." I told her I saw him, but had convinced myself my eyes were playing tricks on me. But no, we both saw someone with no flashlight standing in the trees just off the road, maybe 15 feet from us. I asked if it might have been Josh. Neither of us were really convinced, but wanted to convince ourselves so we could get some sleep. And he had been wandering around being moody 15 minutes before, and it was right by his campsite. I think we didn't want to freak ourselves out any further, so we locked the cabin and didn't talk about it much more. The next morning it was pouring rain, so Josh decided to pack up and leave early instead of spending the day in the area. We shouted goodbye to him as we headed to the bathroom, and he ran around tossing shit in his trunk and trying not to get drenched. That night was a weekend, and there was a big family in the cabin next to ours, and everything felt far less spooky. But when we got back to town a day later, I texted Josh, asking him if he'd been lurking creepily in the woods. He said no. Well, I told him what we'd seen, and he said he'd seen a guy the prior night lurking in the woods without a flashlight. Same general description, which I'll get to, same area. The guy had really creeped him out, so much so that the next day he bought the biggest mag light he could find, so he'd have more than just a pocket knife to defend himself. But he'd also mostly convinced himself it was a park ranger. Yeah, with no flashlight, let alone a vehicle. But he more or less willed himself to believe it so he could get some sleep. So, once we could no longer pretend it was Josh, Sarah and I compared notes. What we both saw and what Josh saw the night before was this. A tall, gaunt white man in his late 40s, with clean-shaven sunken cheeks, in the stand of tree spramble just off the road, in the space between the arms of the F. He was wearing a raincoat, rubber boots and a hat, and had no flashlight. He was just standing still and staring coldly in our direction. I remember his raincoat, his sunken face, and how very cold his gaze felt. In contrast, Josh is several inches shorter than whoever we saw, was not wearing a raincoat that night, which we knew because we'd just seen him. But we convinced ourselves otherwise bearded, 29 years old at the time. I should add, it wasn't raining. To be clear, where this guy was not somewhere you'd be strolling through. It was a thick, brambly area. He had made the effort to move out of the road and to stay in the shadows and away from the bright bathroom light, both nights. We're sure he wasn't going to the bathroom, though we were on the women's side. You can hear the men's side clearly, and Josh had been outside in view of the bathroom doors both nights. He didn't look like he lived in the woods, which is to say, he appeared clean and groomed, and his clothes weren't worn or dirty. Whatever he may have been doing in the middle of the night in a nearly abandoned campground with no flashlight, he was clearly making an effort not to be seen. We all discussed it, and Josh ultimately called the campground to let them know. They said they'd check it out. Although my camping fees were mysteriously refunded, we never heard anything more. Josh is still a little mad at me for seeing a potential murderer lurking in the woods near his tent and not doing anything. Out of curiosity, we just checked to see if anything had happened in the park. A number of people have gone missing in the state park over the years, some slightly mysteriously. Most were found downriver and believed to have fallen into the rapids on accident. I'm sure it's unrelated, but the whole place gives me the creeps, and I still can't figure out what that man was doing. Living on New River Mountain in this county, I have been much wrought up by a phenomenon which has been witnessed there at intervals for several months, but only recently assumed startling proportions. In May, reports were circulated of a mysterious rain of tiny stones, which apparently came out of nowhere. At first, these reports attracted little attention, but as time passed, they became general. In May, several stones fell in a clearing near the cabin of Cy Henley, who lives halfway up the north slope of the mountain. These were jagged pieces of sandstone the size of a walnut. I remember Henley cursing the person supposed to have thrown the stones. One night in June, I was wakened by sounds on the roof like the falling of hail. As I had a little garden patch, I was uneasy as to the effect of the hail. Examination in the morning developed that the hail was composed of tiny stones. I spoke of this to other mountaineers, and it was learned that stones had fallen at other points on the mountain. In July, a clearing almost on top of the mountain was visited by a desultory rain of stones, many of them striking buildings with loud noise and bounding off. A peculiarity of this shower was the presence of several pebbles, which are as rare on that mountain as icicles in August. The superstition of the mountaineers was aroused, and some strange theories were advanced. The reports grew as they went. A newspaper in a neighboring county recently printed a story that showers of stones were constant on the mountains, and that business was suspended on account of the excited condition of the populace. The fact is that the populace consists of not more than a dozen families scattered over the mountains, and there never was any business to suspend. The most peculiar manifestations occurred on the farm of Ellison Fosman, a justice of the peace living on the south slope. Several stones had fallen here at intervals of a day or so, and Ed Meekers, a school teacher of the vicinity, went to Fosman's to investigate. A stone was heard to fall in the yard, and after some search, we found it. It was almost sunk beneath the hard surface of the ground and was smooth, black, and of a perfectly oval shape, and about the size of a robin's egg. Meeker said it was warm when he touched it. Just as he stooped, another stone struck him with a sharp blow in the small of the back. This stone was scarcely larger than a lima bean and about the same shape, although not so regular. A stone about as large as a man's fist and resembling brown hematite iron ore fell on the roof of Addison Butt's house, 2 miles from Fosman's, and bounding off, fell into a barrel of water standing at the corner of the house. It sizzled like hot iron and sent up a little cloud of steam. This stone is undoubted of meteoric origin, as some of the others may be, but the average falling stone is an irregular, jagged bit of sandstone, and small clouds of coarse sand accompany some of the stones. Twigs are broken off trees, shingles split, and corn broken down. Probably a bushel of these stones have fallen, all in all, in the clearings. If, as seems probable, the phenomenon has been general over the mountain, several tons must have fallen. In the valley of New River Mountain, the wildest reports receive credence, and the Rev. John Justin, a local Baptist exhorter, is using them with startling effect at nightly revival meetings at the Little Log Schoolhouse. It was 1970, and my entire family was driving home from Arizona to Washington. My 2 brothers and older sister were asleep in the back seat of our Scout. I was 3 sleeping on my mother's lap in the front seat. My dad always prefers the scenic route, so we were driving through the Painted Desert, Arizona. It was about an hour or so before dawn. My dad says it caught his eye on the right side of the road, just out of nowhere. 1 minute there was no light, and the next it was there softly glowing. As they approached this light, they could see it was a man dressed in a bright, shiny metal suit. It reminded him of armor. He said he seemed to be almost 7 feet tall. The figure stretched out its arm and motioned for them to come forward. He doesn't remember being afraid, just in awe. My mom confirms everything he said up to that point. They lost a couple of hours and don't remember driving out of there. My dad says he came to pump gas. It stayed with him all his life. He was a great artist and drew the scene hundreds of times over the years. It was a day like any other in Wyoming. As a park ranger, my job was as routine as it came: patrolling, maintaining, and ensuring the safety of the park's wildlife and visitors. My name's Bernie, by the way. That evening, I decided to take a walk through a cornfield. I often went bow hunting in my free time, so naturally, I had my bow and arrows with me. The cornfield was silent, except for the rustle of the corn stalks dancing in the breeze. The sun was setting, casting long, eerie shadows that blanketed the field. Suddenly, I felt an odd sensation, like I wasn't alone. It was a primal instinct, that gut feeling of being watched. As I turned around, I came face to face with a huge creature that towered over me. I gasped, my heart pounding in my chest. The creature stood upright, like a man, but covered in thick, matted hair. Its eyes were intense, almost human. I realized then that I was looking at what can only be described as Bigfoot. Fear gripped me, but instinct took over. I reached for my bow and let an arrow fly. It struck the creature square in the chest. With a monstrous roar, it fell to the ground. Slowly, I approached the fallen beast, my heart hammering in my chest. But as I neared, the body just vanished. One moment it was there, the next it was as if it had never existed at all. Dumbfounded and terrified, I sprinted back home. My wife, seeing the ashen color of my face, commented that I looked as white as a cloud. I could barely stammer out what had happened. That evening changed me. Every rustle in the trees, every shadow in the field, I wondered if the creature was watching. Years ago, I experienced something that still haunts me to this day. At the time, I was dating my abusive ex, though I was still deeply in love with him. It's difficult to admit now, but back then, I couldn't see the reality of our relationship. One day, we were sitting together on a bench in Yellowstone National Park, and I found myself laying in his lap while he gently ran his hand through my hair. I remember looking up at him and noticing something strange, as if there were something else present with us. Suddenly, a piercing sound filled my ears, and for a brief moment, I saw a demonic face overlapping my ex's. The demon had horns, and its flesh appeared rough, possibly burnt. Thick, gray smoke swirled around it. It was only for a moment, but I saw the demon laughing and I got you kind of laugh. It was utterly chilling. I've never experienced anything supernatural before or since that incident, and I had never even believed in demons until then. I don't discuss this encounter with many people for obvious reasons, but the memory remains vivid. One day, years after the incident, I was hiking in a national park, and I met a park ranger named Tom. After chatting for a while and feeling a sense of trust, I decided to share my eerie story with him. To my surprise, Tom told me that he had heard of similar experiences from other people who had visited the park over the years. He revealed that some people believed the park was haunted by dark energies that could manifest themselves in various ways. Tom's knowledge of these stories brought me a strange sense of comfort, as it made me feel less alone in my experience. We continued to talk about the supernatural and shared other stories we had heard. By the end of our conversation, I felt a bond with Tom, and I was grateful to have met someone who could understand and validate what I had gone through. As I left the park that day, I couldn't help but wonder about the dark forces that might be lurking in the shadows, waiting to prey on unsuspecting victims. The park that I service gets little to no traffic anymore. Part of that is simply because of how small the town is. Another part of that is today's Americans just don't get out for the fresh air anymore. It's kind of sad, really. I see video games are the new fresh air of today, and tablets and phones and electronics. A lot of them involve getting out into the wild and enjoying fresh air and hunting and surviving. Nobody is really into that anymore. People would rather literally pay money for a simulation than they could just go out themselves and do it. And yet, even as little traffic as our park gets, I still find just enough litter to make me irritated. As if people get out into nature just long enough to ruin it for everyone else. I was cleaning up some wrappers off a park bench when, among them, I noticed something different. There was one of these corn husk dolls, the kind that are fashioned after the type that Native Americans used to make. It didn't have a face, just a blank knob for a head and four nubs for arms and legs. Cute and creepy, I thought to myself, until I noticed a small piece of paper rolled up and tucked into one of its folds. I unrolled it out of curiosity and it said, "Hello there." I smirked and threw it. After I was done picking up all the trash, I went back to my patrol car. When there was another corn doll stuck behind the handle of the door, it too had another message that it read, "I said hello." I kind of prickled and looked around. As far as I could tell, I was the only person in the park and I hadn't seen or heard anyone. But then again, I was very absorbed in my work when I was picking up trash. It's possible that somebody was watching me and playing an elaborate prank just so they could do it for, you know, giggles. Still, I didn't like to think that somebody had gotten by me like that. I quickly got inside my car, shut the door, and no sooner had I done that, I noticed a third doll sitting on my steering wheel, also having another note that said, "Could you use a hand?" I nearly soiled myself when something smacked into the windshield. It took a second to fully register, but I realized it was a severed arm and hand, cut off at the elbow. Immediately, I radioed out that we had something going on in the park, and the response came fairly quick, as you would suggest and expect. But I wasn't sure if it was soon enough to keep whoever this was inside the park. I brought everybody up to speed, and there was a very thorough sweeping. They didn't find anything, no body, no killer, nothing, not even another doll. Forensics even did tests on the severed arm and unfortunately found that it belonged to a child that had been missing for over 2 months. The arm that hit my windshield is relatively fresh, so that meant the kid had died recently. The rest of the day kind of went by in a haze. I felt like a failure for not catching this monster, and all the moments that I could have when he was tampering with my car. Again, we never found anything, and the person was never caught. It's a mystery that will always be left as just that, a mystery. As a park ranger, I have seen a lot of odd things in my time. We get people that come out here for all sorts of reasons, especially in the camping area when it's off season. I've stumbled across all sorts of weird stuff, but so long as that weird stuff is legal and consensual, if you get my drift, then that's up to them, no judgment. Most of them can't even look you in the eye the next morning, and we just have a small chuckle about that. As I said, if you are consenting adults, it's your own business. But one time, I came across something that ended up being a police investigation. You see, I was out and about performing one of the last evening patrols before heading home for the night. We had three tents booked in that night, and it was getting towards winter when the camping area would be closed. Two couples had appeared, and one family with a mother, dad, and two small babies. The tents were fairly spaced out, and just before midnight, everything was quiet. I just finished up, heading back to the office to sign off, when I saw a young girl, probably no older than 18, run past me. She was just in her underwear, and from the quick flash I saw of her face before running off to the trees, she was terrified, all wide-eyed and mouth ready to scream. Immediately, I turned around, shining my flashlight in the direction she'd ran off to. There was nothing. I headed that way and looked all around, calling out even nothing. I recalled the three ladies that were booked into the campsite. They were all older, the mom was likely in her later 30s, and the two women and the couples were around their mid-20s, I would think. There was no good reason for a young girl to be running around in the dead of night when it was freezing cold. So I went through protocol and alerted colleagues and police. They headed out and conducted a more thorough search, woke the campers who were not happy that the babies had been disturbed. But there was no trace, literally no trace. I'm talking zero footprints where I'd seen her, no apparent way in or out that showed any evidence somebody had even ran through here, and no reports of missing teen girls or bodies showing up. I was relieved, but at the same time, not exactly sure what I saw. It did leave the question of, what the hell did I see, or did I possibly hallucinate it? I guess time will tell. So recently my wife and the rest of the family that lives with us have been hearing and or smelling strange sounds. At first we thought it was the stray cats or raccoons, but then things started getting weirder. We started hearing sounds. Sometimes it would be footsteps. Other times we would hear knocking. We thought maybe we smoked a bit too much of the devil's lettuce, but everyone else in the house was also hearing these things. That's when the sound started sounding like people talking to us, but the weird thing was it always sounds like they are incredibly far away. The most recent thing was the smell of a rotten corpse of some kind, but I couldn't for the life of me remember when I last smelled a corpse like that. The smell seemed almost intense, as if it were right in front of me. I checked around our home and under it to make sure there were no dead animals. This happened at almost 12 at night when my wife and I were outside smoking. I had my brother come out and check, and even he agreed that it wasn't just me who smelled it. He said it smells like a corpse of person. That's when I remembered why the smell seemed so familiar, because a man had died a few years ago. And I remember how many times we walked by his corpse. They realized he died inside the wall, but I never forgot the smell. It was a very horrid smell. Still, that smell only has happened once, and it hasn't come back that I know of. I'm usually one to think of scientific reasons. I ended up checking if any possible sewage had leaked from a pipe, or if it came from our neighbor's home, but nothing seemed out of the ordinary. These weird happenings only seem to happen at night, and most of the people who live near us are usually asleep by 10 p.m., and we stay up till about 12 or 1 in the morning. My neighbors have told me that on the few occasions they have been outside at that hour, they say they feel uncomfortable or they hear something, but they chalk up to maybe the random animals or them being tired. I'll post an update if anything significant happens. I would also like any opinions or theories to know what it might be. It was the summer of June 2013, and the high temperatures were not helping farmers. Even though it wasn't a dry year in the state, a few weeks had been a little hotter than usual. I lived in Altamont, Missouri. When some of us would go water the plants at night, we noticed the strange sounds. I got a phone call from my son at 2 a.m. He was very agitated. I figured something was very wrong. For 2 weeks, the family had been living in a state of stress and insomnia. Every other night, we'd drive to their land to water their cornfield. There were noises that we had never heard before. See, we didn't know what it was. We know there are animals out here, we know that. But this sound gave me goosebumps. It goes like a tapping sound, as if somebody was chattering their teeth, only much more faster and louder, then silence, then shrieking. These aren't coyotes or wolves or anything like that. I saw something, and that is not from this land, that I'm sure. It was there standing before me as I pointed the flashlight at it. It was darn big. Then a sudden movement, fast as heck, and it was gone. I can only describe it as an 8-foot-tall winged creature with a long muzzle that resembled the face of an alligator. The animal was featherless and its skin was gray, with a wingspan of over 80 feet that looked like the wings of a bat. The almond-shaped eyes appeared red under the stream of light pointing at them, a known characteristic of certain rodents, opossums, and birds. The only creature that I can reference it to is a pterodactyl, even though I know that sounds crazy. Have you heard of other similar sightings in this area? I truly believe I was abducted by aliens a couple of months ago. My dreams of my house were too vivid to be dreams. Something happened. I remember standing at the patio door looking up. The ship was huge with 2, 3, or 4 big lights. I remember a red and white light. I knew I was looking at the back, but instead of seeing my backyard, there was a field with 2 cars. I think the one closest to me was a red convertible with the top down. There was a woman leaning against the car. I think she had dark curly hair, darker than mine and softer curls. I think 1 or 2 men were sitting in the car drinking. These details are too vivid and too memorable to be a dream. The ship was a very strong material. Gunmetal gray in color. From what I saw, the house blocked the rest of the ship. I was looking up. The clincher is that I was jolted awake in bed. I turned over and the clock read 5:26 a.m. I felt like I had just gotten in bed and I was exhausted. I didn't want to have to get up and go to work. I turned onto my left side and my first thought was that I'd need to get checked out for any implants. I tried to find something on the internet to tell my story, but didn't find anything in that short time. I told my best friend last night, and she doesn't think I'm crazy. When I wrote it, I wrote things going on in my life before and after. There was no break. Also, I remember when I wrote this how calm I became. To clarify how I saw the ship, I have 2 sliding glass doors going outside. I have to open both of them. I remember seeing everything in the den as it is right now, not like a dream where everything is distorted or made up, and I was standing in the house at the first door, with both open in my, probably, nightgown that night. I was looking up, and if I had stepped out and jumped up, I could have touched the ship. It was that close. I have metal awnings, but that night, it was like they were gone. Because the ship was so close, and the view I had, that's why I could only see the back. It was like I was being dropped off. I didn't feel strange or funny or have any weird things. Supernatural things do happen to me at night, but as long as I pray, it helps. I now wear a St. Michael the Archangel medal that was blessed by the Pope and pray to him each night also, and that has helped tremendously. To clarify being exhausted, have you ever gone out one night and partied and got drunk, not too drunk, but enough to know you're drunk and you came in at 4 or 5 or 6 of them? Then you throw yourself in bed and you're asleep before you've stopped moving. That's what I felt like. I had gone to bed the night before as usual, but when I was jolted awake, I looked at the clock see above and literally felt like I had been dropped into my bed and that I had not gotten any sleep. My best friend is the only one I told about this because I'm too scared to talk to anyone else. Maybe I watch too many TV shows and movies, but I have not spoken to anyone about this. I've thought long and hard and I wanted to report this, but I don't want anything bad to happen to me. It was a hot summer day, and I decided to go for a hike on a trail I had heard about from some friends. They had mentioned that it was common for people to skinny dip at the end of the hike, and the idea of taking a refreshing dip in the cool stream sounded like the perfect way to unwind after a long hike. As I walked along the trail, I saw a few people sunbathing in the distance. Wanting some privacy, I decided to head upstream to find a more secluded spot. As I continued along the path, I noticed a lone man on the trail. I politely stepped off to let him pass, assuming he would continue on his way. I finally found a quiet alcove where I felt comfortable enough to strip down and enjoy the cool water. I quickly undressed and submerged myself, feeling the refreshing sensation of the water against my skin. Just as I started to relax, I felt a sudden sense of unease. To my horror, the man from the trail reappeared, standing only a foot behind me, completely naked. He attempted to strike up a conversation, but my instincts were screaming at me that I was in danger. I muttered a response and quickly scrambled out of the water to get dressed. Adrenaline pumping through my veins, I began the 3-mile hike back to my car at a rapid pace. With no cell service in the area, I knew I had to rely on my own instincts to keep myself safe. Every rustle in the bushes, every snapping twig, sent shivers down my spine as I hurried along the trail, praying that I would make it back to my car without incident. When I finally reached my car, I breathed a sigh of relief, grateful to have escaped the situation unharmed. From that day on, I vowed never to hike alone again, always opting for the company of friends on my outdoor adventures. The memory of that terrifying encounter serves as a constant reminder to trust my instincts and always prioritize my safety. It was a quiet night as I drove down the narrow country road, taking my friend back to his village after a long day of hanging out. The clock in the car read just after midnight, and the only source of light came from the dim glow of the headlights cutting through the darkness. As we approached a small bridge, I noticed a peculiar sight, a small cloud-like formation slowly drifting across the road. Just a bit of fog, I thought to myself, not an unusual occurrence on these country roads. My friend, lost in thought, was staring out the window, oblivious to the foggy apparition up ahead. As we got closer, I expected our car to pass through the fog, but what happened next left me baffled and frightened. Instead of us driving through the fog seemed to pass through the car itself. It seemed to defy the laws of nature as the misty cloud moved right between the two of us and out through the back of the car. Startled, I jumped in my seat, gripping the steering wheel tightly. My friend, who hadn't been paying attention to the road, was equally shocked by the phenomenon. He confirmed that he had also witnessed the fog passing through the car, leaving us both bewildered and struggling to make sense of what had just happened. We spent the rest of the drive discussing our eerie encounter, trying to come up with a rational explanation for the strange fog. But to this day, the experience remains unexplained, a chilling memory that lingers in our minds whenever we find ourselves driving down those lonely country roads late at night. As a kid, I dreamt of being an officer like my father and his dad before him. It kind of ran in the family. So every time I was sitting in the passenger seat of my partner's cop car, it was even more special. It was my very first night, and my partner kept joking on me, ripping on me, and calling me a rookie. But I didn't mind. I was very familiar with the hazing process. It was a boring night. My partner made attempts to break the silence by asking me all sorts of various questions. Other than that, it was silent. Not much was happening. We looked around for somebody to apprehend, but to no avail so far. Not much of a first day. We kept on driving with nothing happening until I saw a figure standing on the corner. I told my partner, "Is that something there?" I pointed to the figure that I can now see was a taller man, standing with his head to the ground. She looked around for a bit before shaking her head and concluding it was probably just a homeless man. We drove off. I looked out the window as we passed, He turned his head and watched as we drove off. I thought it was weird, but not weird enough to get involved. We kept on driving when we got a call on the radio. 5 on 150 on South and Boulevard. My partner picked up the radio and told them we'd be on the way. I faintly remembered the 5U-150 from training. It had something to do with the crazies. We took a turn to get there faster, and in less time than I'd imagined, we pulled into the house and property they described over the radio. Loaded our weapons, exiting the car, I looked around again. A very quick scan of the neighborhood. That's when on the corner opposite of the one we had come in, I saw him again. The man from earlier, looking down at the floor. I tapped my partner and motioned towards him. She looked at him, and I can tell she was just as confused as I was. She whispered to me, "You get in the house, I'll go talk to him." I nodded, heading into the house. It was huge, and to my knowledge, abandoned. "Hello, it's the police. Is anybody there?" Just then, from a heap on the floor, I heard somebody speak. "You need to leave now. Go." It was coming from a man holding a wound on his side and bleeding badly. "Sir, who did this to you?" I asked, flashing the flashlight in his direction. "Get out. Get your partner and get out of here before he gets mad," he said, fear audibly in his voice. "Who gets here?" I responded, hearing a little bit of fear in my own voice. He opened his mouth, but before he could speak, there was a gunshot that got both of our attention. I ran outside to see my partner now face down. The man she was talking to was nowhere to be found. I rushed out to her side, kneeling down beside her, flipping her over before checking her pulse. I felt nothing. To show her respect, I closed her eyes before setting her back down. Unholstering my weapon, I walked back into the house aiming it. But to my surprise, the now bleeding man was not there. The house was empty, and his spot was a streak of blood heading out the back door, which I saw now had been busted open. I ran through, looking around. There, at the corner of the fence, stood the tall man, looking down. "All right, you freak. Hands up." He didn't move. It's like my badge and gun meant nothing to him. He did not fear me. "What are you hard of hearing?" I said. "Put your hands up," trying to make my voice sound more macho now. "And that's how we're playing it," I said, fed up. "One, and two." Before I could get to three, he turned to me, looking at me. What I saw made me drop my weapon. His stare felt cold, but he could not be staring at me. There were two empty spots on his face where his eyes would usually go. I stumbled backwards into the house, nearly losing my balance but catching myself in the sink, vomiting a bit. I was still shaken up by everything that's happened. It all happened so quickly. I stood over the sink, waiting for the urge to vomit to make a reappearance, and I'd heard footsteps approaching. It was the man I saw before. He came in, wiping the blood from his shirt. He was not injured at all. "I'm sorry, it was truly nothing personal," he claimed with a smug smirk on his face. "You see, my boy has this craving for human flesh, and a boy's gotta eat." He continued to walk towards me. "What is wrong with his eyes?" I said frantically, considering I was more than likely going to die. "He was born without them. Doctors can't explain it, but my boy didn't let it get him down. He doesn't need eyes. He goes by his hearing and his smell." He looked out the door, and here he comes now. I knew what was coming. Just thinking about that freakishly tall, eyeless man and my partner made me sick. I vomited all over the man and myself. He took a step back and called me a disgusting fool, explained to me there would be no mercy, and I ran as fast as I could, grabbing my radio and calling for backup immediately. I actually had to drive down the street to try and hide from this person until my backup arrived. He and his son were detained, and as it turns out, he had actually cut out his son's eyes as a part of some sort of sick, satanic, sadistic cult and fed him H flesh his entire life, treating him like a wild animal. As far as I know, him and his son are still serving time in prison. My sister, Clara, and I were thrilled to be spending time with our family at Medibems Lake. Our parents and uncles had taken us on a week-long fishing trip, and we couldn't have been happier. The lake was a beautiful, serene escape from the world, and we eagerly embraced the opportunity to fish for smallmouth bass from the rocky island near our campsite. Each evening, as the sun began to set, Clara and I would head out to the island with our fishing gear, eagerly anticipating the catch we would bring back to our family. The island was a magical place, with its rugged rocks and the sound of water lapping against the shore. It was there that we felt closest to nature and the wonders it held. One night, as we sat on the rocks with our lines cast out into the water, we heard a strange howling noise echoing across the lake. It was unlike anything we had ever heard before, a melodious singing from someone with a husky voice, haunting and beautiful. Clara and I exchanged puzzled glances, unsure of what could be making such a sound. The singing continued for several minutes before it abruptly stopped, leaving us even more curious and a little unnerved. We decided to pack up our gear and head back to camp, eager to share our strange experience with our family. The following evening, Clara and I returned to the island, unable to resist the lure of the lake and the chance to catch more fish. As we sat on the rocks, the sun setting behind us, we once again heard the eerie singing. This time, however, we were not alone. From the shadows of the island's trees, two enormous, hair-covered giants emerged, their eyes fixed on us with an unsettling intensity. They stood at least 8 feet tall, their bodies covered in thick, matted hair, and their faces a mix of human and animal features. Frozen with fear, we watched as the giants approached us, their hands outstretched towards our bucket of fish. Without a word, they took the fish, their eyes never leaving ours, and then disappeared back into the shadows from which they had come. Clara and I sat in stunned silence, our hearts pounding in our chests. What had we just witnessed? Were these creatures some sort of undiscovered species, or perhaps beings from another world? We couldn't begin to fathom the answers to our questions. We returned to our campsite, our story spilling out in a jumble of excited and frightened words. Our family listened with a mix of skepticism and concern, unsure of what to make of our tale. In the years that followed, the memory of that night remained etched in our minds, a reminder of the mysteries that still lurked in the world. Our encounter with the hair-covered giants would remain one of the most extraordinary experiences of our lives, a moment when the veil between the known and the unknown was briefly lifted, revealing the incredible possibilities that lay beyond. This took place last year at the beginning of summer. I was with my mom, headed down to my Nana's farm to visit for a weekend. For some context, she lives on a farm way back in the country right at the foot of a mountain in rural South Carolina. It's a very rural, secluded area, so the roads are badly maintained and barely wide enough for two cars to pass one another. The houses are also spread out and set far back into the tree line from the road, so there's very little ambient light besides the headlights of a car. So my mom and I are driving along, her in the driver's seat and me in passenger. It was around 11 p.m. and we're 15 minutes out from Nana's, deep in the woods with the radio down almost to silent. We come onto this straight stretch of the road in a heavily wooded area, and suddenly this blur of a creature darts out across the road, right at the edge of our headlights. It was moving pretty good, but both me and my mom were able to get a good look at it and both agree on what we saw. It was a fairly large creature, roughly the size of a person bigger. Neither of us could make out the head, but we both remember it appearing to have a segmented body, my mom's words, as if it were emaciated and its rib cage was poking out. The reflection of light made it hard for me to tell color, but my mom said she remembered it to be dark and she didn't see forehair. It had long limbs, and as it moved across the road, it didn't run the way a dog or horse would, with all four legs. The best word to describe it would be loping, using its front limbs to pull itself along, and it was moving considerably fast. We both said something along the lines of, "What the hell is that?" as it crossed in front of us. As we got up to where it had crossed, I turned to look at it just as it reached the other side of the road and out of our headlights. And I swear on my life, it stood up and ran. not like a dog rearing on its hind legs, it was definitely bipedal. I immediately yelled that it had stood up, and we both started getting nervous. I honestly would have thought I was going insane had I not had another person in the car with me. My mom has always been a pretty level-headed person and not superstitious, but she was very nervous and made me agree to not tell my nana about it to avoid scaring her, which made me recognize how serious this was. I should also mention that there had apparently been a series of attacks on livestock horses in the area around the time this happened. People were saying they found wire fences ripped through and their animals attacked. I don't think any died, but if I remember correctly, there were a few horses that were severely wounded. There have been a few other strange instances in the area, but that was my personal experience. When my dad was a kid, he and my grandpa went to my grandpa's land to prepare the soil for planting crops. Bored, my dad wandered off to a nearby stream where he saw a bunch of human-like dolls playing around in the water. He said they looked like adults, only smaller, with proportions like dolls, not sure what exactly that means. They splashed around in the water, and at times it looked like they were even walking on it. They signaled at him to come and play with them, and my dad ran over excitedly. He said he played with them for a while when my grandpa noticed that he had wandered off and went to find him. When my grandpa found my dad seemingly playing alone by the stream, getting all wet, he got super mad and dragged him away. Apparently, my grandpa and grandma were never able to the Duens whenever my dad would point them out. My dad still recalls looking back while my grandpa yanked him away and seeing the Duens waving goodbye at him. After that, my dad started seeing the Duens around the house. They'd pop out from behind walls during dinner, and my dad would try to feed them scraps of food, much to my grandparents' annoyance. Eventually, they got worried and took him to a local curandera. She did a little ritual and told him to keep a cigarette behind his ear for a week. And then, the Duens were gone. He never saw them again. My dad swears it's all true, even though no one believes him, and he's embarrassed about even telling the story. The only reason he told me it was because my mom teased him about it the other day, and I forced it out of him. I love these kinds of stories and really wanted to share. If you have any Duen stories, please share. I'd love to hear them. My aunts and uncles say Duens aren't always so friendly, and told me some other creepy stories about them. My best friend Vinny and I were out riding our motor scooter on a beautiful sunny day. We had been coasting downhill when the road started to rise, so we kicked on the motor, approaching a level overlook area of a clear cut about the size of two football fields. Before us, at the far end of the field, down below near the trees, something astonishing caught our eyes. A massive creature arose from a fetal sleeping position. It was a Bigfoot. It looked straight at us before swiftly heading south with its arms swinging. As it passed a stump, it took one giant step up into the forest and disappeared from view. We almost fell off our scooter, scrambling to grab our camera and binoculars while trying to process what we had just witnessed. The creature was huge, with a flat face that clearly wasn't a gorilla. Vinny insisted that we explore the area, so we carefully walked down several feet of clear-cut debris to the spot where the Bigfoot had been sleeping. All we found were impressions where the creature had been lying down, but nothing else. We noticed that the stump it had passed was 8 feet tall, and the creature had been chest-high over it. The single step it took into the forest was at least 3 feet tall. We were both in awe and terrified at the same time. It was October 1993, and my cousin Jane and I were excited to embark on an elk hunting trip on Vinegar Hill. The area was known for its abundance of elk, and we were hoping to bag a big one. Little did we know that our hunting trip would turn into an unforgettable adventure. As we trekked along the creek, we came across a large muddy spot. To our surprise, we found 5 enormous Bigfoot tracks leading into the mud. Each track measured 20 inches long, and they were spaced far apart. Jane and I exchanged puzzled glances, wondering if what we were seeing was real. The following year, during elk bow hunting season, we found ourselves back in the same area, The memory of the Bigfoot tracks still fresh in our minds, we couldn't help but feel a little uneasy. As we hunted in the daylight around 2 p.m., we suddenly heard a loud, piercing eek sound echoing through the forest. Startled, we both dashed back to camp, our hearts pounding. At sunset, our friend Jeremy joined us at camp. As we discussed the day's events, Jeremy noticed movement by a bush and between three trees. He squinted, trying to make out what he was seeing. In the fading light, he saw a dark, shaded figure moving through the trees. It was tall, around 6.5 to 7 feet, and walked upright like a human. At first, Jeremy thought it might be his brother, but as the figure disappeared into the woods, he realized it was something else entirely. We couldn't help but think back to the Bigfoot tracks we had found the previous year. Could it be that we had just seen the elusive creature responsible for those massive footprints? We later learned that the area was honeycombed with mines, raising the question of whether these creatures used them as shelter. Though we never had another encounter with the mysterious figure, our elk hunting trips on Vinegar Hill would forever be tinted with a sense of wonder and curiosity about the legendary Bigfoot. While on a deer hunting trip, my father stopped the vehicle on the side of the road to have lunch. As myself and my three brothers ate, I noticed movement several hundred yards away out of my peripheral vision. I realized that something was up in a tree near the very top of a huge pine tree where the branches are just beginning to grow, at the edge of the timber cutting area. The area had just recently been logged. I looked at it with binoculars and was frightened when I realized that it was not a bear, but a huge man-like creature picking something from the treetop. I looked at it for several minutes. It was very dark brown and had its legs and at least one arm wrapped around the tree. It kept reaching up and grabbing stuff like it was collecting something. Then suddenly it turned to look in my direction when I saw the face very clearly. It had no hair near the eyes and nose, which looked humanoid and definitely did not have a snout like a bear at all. Then it did a double look, then realized that we were watching it, and without any notice just pushed itself away from the tree and free fell at least 60 feet to the ground with its feet and body staying in the prone position all the way. When it landed, it made a very loud crashing sound into the freshly logged clear cut. My father screamed at us to hurry and get into the vehicle, and we drove away fast, and he never talked about it to me again. My brothers did not see it because they were looking in the wrong direction with their binoculars. Very spooky, though. I had just finished a long walk through the forest. The smell of decomposing leaves filled the air, but suddenly I caught a whiff of something far more pungent. It was like a rotting animal carcass. As the smell intensified, I couldn't shake off the feeling that I was being watched. As I walked down our dirt driveway, I heard a deep snort like a huffing noise. It reminded me of the sound a horse makes when it wants your attention. Intrigued, I looked around and saw a large male Bigfoot standing there, staring right at me. I was both fascinated and terrified at the same time. With my heart pounding, I took a cautious step, and to my amazement, the Bigfoot mirrored my movement. This continued for about 5 minutes, with the creature copying my every action. Feeling a mix of excitement and fear, I decided to run back to my house to grab a camera. As I fumbled to find my camera, I thought about the park ranger, who had been a friend and confidant for years. He had shared numerous stories about unusual sightings and unexplained phenomena in the forest. I couldn't wait to tell him about my encounter and show him the evidence. But when I finally stepped outside, camera in hand, the Bigfoot was gone. Disappointed but still eager to share my story, I went to the ranger station and relayed my experience to him. The park ranger listened intently, his eyes widening with each detail I shared. He told me that there had been other reports of similar encounters in the area, and my story only added to the growing mystery. Together, we went back to the spot where I had seen the Bigfoot, but there was no trace of the creature. The park ranger promised to keep an eye out for any future sightings and urged me to do the same. From that day on, every time I ventured into the forest, I couldn't help but hope for another chance encounter with the elusive Bigfoot. It was the end of August, a perfect time for a vacation, and I, Donald, had decided to indulge my hobby of prospecting for gold. So there I was on the Chetco River, about 18 miles northeast of Brookings, hoping to strike it rich. And guess what? I found a vein. But that's not the story I want to tell you. What happened next was far more exciting and much more terrifying. After a day of exploring the area, driving the dirt roads in my trusty old Jeep, I had decided to take a break. I parked the Jeep by the road to let the engine cool, the very dry and steep slope lined with thick brush just a few feet away. Visibility into the undergrowth was no more than 15 feet, but it was peaceful, serene. Then, without warning, the tranquility was shattered. Something charged at me through the brush. I couldn't see what it was, but I could hear it, a rustling sound that grew louder and closer. Then, just as suddenly as it had started, it stopped. Whatever it was lurking in the brush about 35 feet away. I could hear it moving, but I couldn't see it. My heart was pounding in my chest, and I felt a cold rush of adrenaline. Thoughts raced through my mind. Was it a bear, an elk, or something else? I couldn't shake off the feeling of dread. I needed to protect myself. I rushed to the trunk of my Jeep and pulled out my Magnum gun. "I'm ready for you," I muttered, trying to sound braver than I felt. But nothing happened. Whatever it was, it didn't come any closer. The confrontation, if you can call it that, lasted about 3 to 4 minutes, but it felt like an eternity. Shaken by the experience, I decided to consult a local park ranger. A friend had introduced me to Ranger Ben, a grizzled veteran who knew the area like the back of his hand. We discussed the possibility of another animal bear, elk, or even a cougar, but Ben wasn't so sure. "You know," he said, leaning back in his chair, "there are stories around these parts. Stories about a creature living deep in the woods. Some call it Bigfoot." I scoffed at the idea, but deep down, the unease lingered. Was it possible? Had I had a confrontation with Bigfoot? I guess I'll never know. But one thing's for sure, that vacation was one I'll never forget. This incident happened back in 1995 when I was 15 years old. It was very horrible. I witnessed two guys that may have been like government agents or some other secretive governmental agents. They kidnapped my dad and left someone in his place that looked just like him. I later found out that the person left behind was a reptilian cloaked as a human. This person became rather rude to me as time went on. However, he talked with me, and he could even heal with his bare hands. He told me that we humans were looked down upon as sheep, etc. And he knew I had witnessed the two agents kidnapping my dad, and he said I was next. I became very scared. He had me taken to a place against my will, and met with what looked like a special forces group who forced me to sign paperwork against my will, and the guy who looked identical to my dad was standing there. I was spying on him one night and saw what looked like a snake's tongue come out of his mouth. I later discovered he was a reptilian, a very short human who looked like a midget was helping him. I think he was a gray cloaked human. I heard them talk in English, but then started talking in alien lingo, which sounded kind of Far Eastern. "Yes, I am here to tell you they can cloak and simulate our world undercover. My real dad, the one I saw whisked away, was retired military, and I often suspected him of doing something or being involved with the government or doing something secretive that may have led to all this happening to me. I also found implants that feel like something under my skin. One was an upside-down triangle or diamond shape. They also stabbed me and then heated me with their eyes, which left a very weird scar on my leg. I never told anyone as I was so scared of how these entities seemed to be able to operate with impunity and like nothing could stop them. They also conducted very horrible activities and what seemed like mental brainwashing experiments on me. After all these years, I'm still scared to this day. But I believe it was time to come forward. I just wonder what happened to my real dad." My family and I had decided to take a trip to New Orleans, the city of jazz, voodoo, and legends. We checked into an old, historic hotel in the heart of the city, excited to experience the unique atmosphere that surrounded us. One night, after a day of exploring the city, my dad and I settled into bed, the room enveloped in darkness. The only light seeping in was from the lamp post outside, casting eerie, dancing shadows on the walls. My dad was already sound asleep, his steady breathing a comforting presence in the room. I lay facing his back, my thoughts meandering through the events of the day. Restless, I rolled over to face the other side of the room. That's when I saw it, a shadowy figure of a man wearing a hat and a long coat, clutching a briefcase. I strained my eyes, but his face remained indiscernible, as if he were an outline or a shadow, rather than a physical presence. He just stood there, still and silent, an eerie sentinel in the dark. Panic surged through me, and I wondered if I was experiencing sleep paralysis. But as I shifted my body, blinked my eyes, I realized I could still move. My heart raced, my mind grasping for an explanation. Was it a trick of the light? A figment of my imagination? The figure remained, an unwelcome intruder in the room. I never experienced anything like that again, but the memory of that night in New Orleans has lingered, a chilling reminder of the unknown. I've shared my story, curious to know if others have encountered something similar. What was it that I saw that night, a specter from the past, or just a figment of my imagination? The answer remains shrouded in mystery. The day after my girlfriend and I saw the Mothman prophecies in the movie theater, we found ourselves driving up a road situated in the middle of Jefferson City, Missouri. The movie was still fresh in our minds, and we couldn't help but feel a bit on edge. As we made our way up the big hill on Southwest Boulevard, an unexpected event took place. Out of nowhere, a bird-like creature that bore an uncanny resemblance to the one from the movie suddenly bounced off my windshield. The impact startled both of us, and I remember thinking that I had never seen anything quite like it before. Right when the creature hit my windshield, my girlfriend cried out, "Whoa!" The first thing that crossed my mind was how much it reminded me of the bird-like thing from the movie. Just as I was thinking that, my girlfriend said, "That looked like the thing in the Mothman prophecies." Though it wasn't the 7-foot humanoid creature with red eyes and wings that the movie depicted, it still left us feeling uneasy. I couldn't bring myself to look back and see what happened to whatever it was that hit the windshield, nor did I have the nerve to stop and investigate. Maybe I was too freaked out, or perhaps I was worried about what I might find. To this day, I still wonder about that peculiar sighting in Jefferson City, Missouri. Whether it was a mere coincidence or something more inexplicable, the experience remains etched in my memory, serving as a reminder that there are still mysteries in this world that defy explanation. I have heard the story of the Quaker man who left Philadelphia to start a new life in the mountains of Pennsylvania. He was a man of strong faith, and after purchasing a large lot in Cook Township, he found employment at the Old South Mountain Iron Works. The land was perfect for him, with a stream full of brook trout, plentiful timber, and lots of open space to raise a family. He soon met a young woman and fell deeply in love with her. They were married by the local justice of the peace, despite the fact that she was not of the same religious faith as he was. However, they were happy together, and she soon became pregnant. In the final month of her pregnancy, the young wife began to experience bouts of anger and intense pain. The doctor could not diagnose the cause of her malady and ordered her to complete bed rest. The Quaker had a horrible dream that the devil had come to visit their home while he was at work. He was sure that his wife was possessed by a demonic being and that he needed to purge her of this evil. For 10 days straight, he knelt by her bedside, invoking prayers and charms, much to the chagrin of his wife. However, his wife soon became disgusted by the fuss her husband was making. In a fit of rage, she grabbed a small wooden cross and flung it out of the window. She declared that there was no God and that the devil was only a creation of a feeble mind. That very night, the Quaker's wife went into labor. She told in agony for the entire night and into the early morning. A midwife was quickly summoned for the delivery. Soon after daybreak, the child started its way into the world. As the midwife coaxed the new mother to push, it soon became apparent that this child was unlike any she had ever witnessed. The newborn boy resembled a beast, not a human. It was alive and breathing, but did not cry or make any sound. It was gray in color and had more scales than skin. It had a long tail and small horn buds above its pointed ears. There were claws for hands and hooves for feet. It also emitted a foul, lingering stench. This was the embodiment of Mephistopheles. The Quaker was horrified and could not believe that this was his child. He refused to even touch it. The midwife, who had seen many things in her time, was shocked and did not know what to do. The child lived for only a few minutes before passing away. The Quaker's wife died soon after giving birth. The Quaker was left alone with his thoughts and his beliefs. He eventually left the mountains and returned to Philadelphia, where he tried to reconcile his faith with the terrible thing that had happened to him. The story of the Quaker and his wife has been passed down through generations. Some say it was a curse, others say it was a punishment for the wife's blasphemy. But the truth remains a mystery, lost to time and to the mountains of Pennsylvania. Okay, this happened a couple of years ago, before we turned 18 and before uni started. So we had a lot of spare time and nowhere to spend it, so my friends and I would often just walk around our town at night talking about random stuff. On the night in question, it was just me and one friend, and we were just walking without really paying attention to where we were going since we were in pretty deep conversation. We found ourselves walking towards an entrance to a footpath that's behind an estate. There's a fork in the path, and going left will eventually take you to the high street and a train station. Going right will take you to some fields behind a cemetery. We went right, which sounds like a dumb idea, but it made sense at the time because you could get into the cemetery through the fields and then onto the estate where we lived by coming out of the cemetery. Initially, I didn't even want to go down the path in the first place. I'm scared of the dark and generally would rather not walk through a graveyard and a bunch of creepy forest paths at night. My friend reassured me though, and after all, it was the quickest way home. About 5 minutes in, the path leads through a small wooded area, and after that there is the gate that opens into the cemetery. It's really dark in this part, except for some distant lights from houses allowing you to see a little bit in front of you. That's when we saw a figure in the distance, walking towards us. From what I could make out, it just looked like one guy, probably a similar age to us because teens would often use this path to get from one estate to the other. I quietly told my friend that, and he agreed. We weren't worried because while there are some bad kids in our area, people don't really give you any trouble when they're on their own. As the person walked closer to us and us to them, I realized it was not a teenager, but a really tall man. Trying to calm myself, I remembered a tall guy I see a lot walking his dog, a big Alsatian. Yes, it must be him. I scanned the area for his dog, but I saw nothing. However, the man was holding something long in his hand. I thought it was a lead for his dog, but it wasn't flexible, and in the dark and in my paranoid state, I thought it looked like the handle of an axe or a spade. My friend and I hadn't said a word since the man got close, but I just knew he was thinking the exact same thing as me. I didn't want the man to notice that I was staring at him, so I just looked down and walked as fast as I could without running. Thankfully, the gate was right there, and once we got into the cemetery, we felt safe. Once we got out into the open, we started talking about what we saw, and my friend agreed it looked like an axe or really big stick, and said I was expecting to get a blow to the head as soon as we got near him. I babbled a bit, sorry, but I certainly stay away from dark paths now. Hello all. I wanted to share these two stories I have from my childhood that have always stuck with me and still creep me out to this day. Story 1. This story is short but makes me feel uneasy nonetheless. I was in kindergarten as Mrs. Quigley's class. I loved her when she got a call from the office that someone was there to pick me up. I think this was before the time of like emergency contact forms with designated people to sign you out. Because this happened so long ago, I can't remember if there was a name given or not. But I do remember being 5 years old and not feeling right. I told Mrs. Quigley I didn't know that person and didn't want to go with them. She didn't make me, and I rode the bus home as usual that day. I can't help but think that situation was something bad, because I don't remember it ever being a problem that I didn't get picked up that day like it wasn't planned, and it wasn't inconvenient that I didn't go with them. Story 2. My cousin and I were playing outside in a wooded area near her house, and this wooded area was also next to a road. I just remember we were playing in there, then this pickup truck stopped on the road next to us. I don't remember what he said. I just remember taking off and my cousin tripping over a branch and falling. I was too scared to help her. Back when I was younger, around 12, 13, my three friends, and I also the same age, had a fort right at the tree line by some woods near our neighborhood. Right next to the tree line was a series of fields used for sports, so technically our fort was on that property and not the woods. Separating the woods from the fields was a large chain link fence. One day after a large storm, one of the trees from our fort was knocked over. Leaning against the fence, naturally as kids, we thought that was awesome, except for ruining part of the fort. We all climbed up on the tree, sat on it, and whatnot. After some time, we were just sitting there having a conversation when I noticed one of my friends who was not on the tree was looking kind of past us, on the other side of the fence. Guys, he said in a shaky tone. We all turn around, and on the other side of the fence about 20 feet away was an old man. He was dressed in tattered clothes, including a newsboy hat. He looked to be in his mid-50s to 60. He stood there smiling at us. I definitely sensed some malicious intent with him, which is creepy in itself, but the part that gets me the most was how long he must have been there watching us, easily 15-20 minutes before my friend noticed. And what seemed like forever, none of us spoke, and all we could do was stare back at him. My adrenaline kicked in, and my reaction was to just run away, where my friends also followed. After a few minutes or so, we gained the courage to go back, and when we did, he was gone. It kind of scared us, and we really never went back to that fort. Now the fence is replaced, and the fort is gone, but my friends and I will never forget that creepy man. Thanks for listening, Horror Cowboys. See you tomorrow at the same time.